You know what? There aren't enough educated, progressive black male voices. No politically correct bullshit. I'm just one guy with a valuable opinion, bringing you the real, for real.
Listen, we are back from the tropics. How was the tropics, Christina?
I had a wonderful time. Your time. Thank you so much.
Okay, had to get my Dunkin'.
Hello?
Had to get my Dunkin'.
You come back, that's what you get.
That's what you get.
Okay.
It's all over the airport. All
the
stops.
Yes, all the time.
Even when you get out to Uber, it's like mad at these Dunkin'. So, you know, I had to get my decaf with my glaze.
Is that your go-to?
It's my go-to.
Okay.
I usually don't even drink this much coffee.
What happened?
Well, this is the thing. After you come back from the tropics,
mm-hmm.
you have a craving for, like, American things.
Oh, yeah.
And that. America runs on Dunkin'. America runs on Dunkin'. Listen, if you're not watching this on YouTube.com/TheBlackMedia, you should be.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Because we have antics and things. Listen, this is your first segment.
I mean, let's go.
What's new with you?
Child, now I just bit my tongue. That's what's new with me, okay? I just, my fat ass was eating that damn donut too, that glazed Dunkin' Donut, and I have not bit my tongue since I was a little kid. Christina was like, are you okay? I said, listen.
And then I kept drinking. You didn't speak to me for a second.
For a whole minute, I had to just take it in. Listen, but aside from that, I thought I mentioned this before, but clearly I didn't. Listen, I got pots.
Come through, pots.
These pots are called Juanitas, okay? And I'll tell you why, okay? Because I have a show called Up in My Kitchen that I do. And now, look, I don't have a lot of money. I do what I can.
Mm-hmm.
I does what I do. And a supporter of mine was like, you know, you should get some stainless steel pots and you should stop using your... They were, like, complaining about how I use metal on stuff, whatever.
Okay.
Like, I don't use a proper tools. Listen, but the food be good, okay?
Right.
So I was like, listen, she complained, and I was like, well, if you want to buy me some, you can. She was like, okay, and I will. And I was like, okay,
sure.
So do it. And then she was like, she inboxed me and was like, what's your address? And I sent her my address, like, a few weeks later.
Oh, my gosh.
Came to my, I said, oh, my goodness. The
Hello?
Because God knew I needed some new pots. Listen,
thank you.
These got tops and shit. And these are just a few. Cheap.
Oh.
It's like a whole set.
Okay.
We're in my kitchen right now. So it's that one, this one, this one, this one. There's a pot in the refrigerator with some spaghetti in it. So, her name is Miss Juanita. Miss Juanita. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I said thank you to her privately. And I put it in one of the Up in My Kitchen videos.
Okay.
But I wanted to say it on the podcast because my mother was like, did you ever thank her? I was like, yeah. I was like, I didn't talk about it on the podcast. She was like, nah. I was like, that's crazy because I thought I made that a segment on the podcast. But listen, we were in the tropics. Things were happening. So thank you so much, Miss Juanita. So whenever you hear me refer to Juanitas, could you please get Juanita over there? You know what I'm talking about, the pots.
Right, right.
You know what I'm talking about, the pots. Thank you so much. So the last thing that happened to me was, you know, not necessarily happened, but I have my little show up in my kitchen. And most of the time, I just let the ancestors lead me. Y'all, the ancestors then led my ass to a banana muffin with chocolate chips. I said, I don't know if I would like that. But I was in my bed and the ancestors was like, get up. I
Ooh.
Said, God, is that you? No. Oh, okay. Well, to be clear,
right.
It wasn't God. And I went downstairs and I literally was just moving. I didn't have any measurements. I didn't have any recipe.
Mm-hmm.
I was just moving. I said, okay, I did 3 bananas before, so let me do 4.
Okay.
2 eggs, sour cream. You know, I just was moving.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, let me get these chocolate chips that's in the refrigerator.
Shut up.
I poured the chocolate chips in there, made the batter, and they were so good. Listen, the fact that I can't show you is because I don't really have any left. Now, there are 2 in the refrigerator right now, but I'm giving...
They're spoken for.
I can't just be playing with people's food on that show. That's crazy.
Right.
Like,
mm-hmm.
So, you know, I'm just saying, y'all need to watch my show Up in My Kitchen. You need to follow me on Facebook at Tahir C. Register or on my Instagram at Tahir Register and follow me. Then you'll be able to see how much I cook. Listen, I'm a chef.
He is.
I'm a chef.
I give you that.
Red beans and rice.
Hello?
You tore that up.
Dumb good.
Listen, and that's just one dish. Earlier today, I made some tacos,
okay.
Some shrimp tacos.
The shrimp was crunch.
Crunch,
okay.
And they've been sitting there for a minute now.
Uh-huh.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's get into the next segment, our fat asses.
Now see, that's some
black shit.
It's been a minute since we've done black shit. Listen, I done found some. First of all, I always find some black shit. Let's start there. But this, I found this one. I think it was on Facebook, Christina.
Okay.
And I was like, now, you see, this is something black people would say. It says, if you want to be happy, get an old person from 1990 through 1999 and settle down. Those people are tired. And then somebody was like, if those from 1990 to 1999 are considered as old people, what does that make those born between 19, listen, because I'm old, clearly, because I'm old. What does that make those born between 1980 and 1989? And he was like, you mean the ancestors? Mm-mm. I can't. I will not.
Offended.
Offended. Not ancestors. Are those your people?
That's me. I'm an ancestor.
No, aren't you the same age as me?
No, my birthday's next month.
You are an ancestor. See? And you're very ancestral. I just wanted to you give ancestral.
No.
Moments.
Really?
You do. That's why I have you as the voice of reason. Where are you coming from? Where are you coming from? It's okay. Very ethereal. Listen, the next thing I found, or at least was given to me recently. Now you notice some black shit. Only a black woman while sprinting what seemed to be on like an Olympic field. I think it was like a world run, like a world stage or something like that, would fix her hair, her weave.
I mean.
As she's winning, like she was winning, breaking records, you know, world known as one of the fastest sprinters in the world.
That's right.
From Jamaica, where we just were. We were just Jamaica. Uh-huh. You hear the accent? Listen.
It's because we was down there for too long.
We was down there in the tropics sometimes for too long. Sometimes, you know, you don't know.
Hello?
Go to the bathroom. You right. know, like, it just, you know, it just happens. Umbrella. Mm-hmm. And this girl was sprinting almost at the finish line. Mm-hmm. And that wave said, oh. And she said, absolutely not. She said, you won't break my... Listen.
Right. I feel like... What we not about to do.
What we not finna do
right.
is on national TV, okay? Get snatched off my head.
This get,
okay, listen. We gonna cross this finish line together.
Together.
Not one by one, you know?
No.
I'm not finna leave you back here.
Right.
Okay. I understand that this must set my focus. But because I'm a black woman...
Just real quick.
I can do it all. I can do it. Christina, has your hair ever almost left your spirit?
No, not as a whole piece, but like individual braids.
Pieces.
They just like jumped out.
People just don't know what I'm about. Like the pieces of you.
Yes. Have just,
okay, I see.
On the ground. I was like, let me get for somebody's hair.
You see one of these? Listen. If you're not watching this on YouTube, you have to. YouTube.com/TheBlackMedia. Those of you who listen, and listen, I understand you're in your car, you're going to work, you're in the shower, or have you. You gotta watch online, especially because y'all need to see that video of that girl fixing her
Yes.
Wig. I just showed a little clip and y'all gotta see that. But listen, let's get into the next segment.
Thoughts from the people.
Listen, on this part of Thoughts of the... I don't even like part. Listen, on this... Segment. Okay, thank you. Don't cover my show.
Oh, my God.
No. Listen, on this segment of Thoughts of the People, I brought somebody in. Makeup artist and media personality, Rob. Okay?
Hi, y'all, everybody.
Listen, I've known Rob since high school. Mm-hmm. And you can follow him on his Instagram page, Rob God.
R-O-B-T-H-G-O-D.
I'm gonna put the thing in the that's ghetto. I'm gonna put the thing in the thing. I'm not about to just like do you dirty. But Robith, because he's very biblical. Robith the God. That's a lie. Robith the God is Robith. Robith God.
So
is
what it is. Be Robith God.
God. Yeah. Right. But yeah, we instead of like doing Thoughts of the People and like reaching out to people online, I felt like today's topic, especially because it was so ridiculous, like, deserved a person sitting here. Sesame Street. Mm. Have you ever been to Sesame? Is it called Sesame Street or Sesame Place?
I've been to Sesame Place. Sesame Street is a
is the show.
At the place.
Oh, right. Okay. He'd be... Okay.
I guess that makes sense, right?
But okay, so Sesame Place. You saw the thing that happened with Sesame Place.
Oh my God, yes.
Have you ever been to Sesame Place?
I think so. I feel like I went as a kid. I remember being a school trip.
Right. I've definitely been to Sesame Place like 1,000 times. Mm-hmm. One of my favorite places. I've been a lot. It's one of my favorite places. Oh my I think God. One of the first trips me and my father, my brother, my sister, like family trip we ever took was to Sesame Place
right,
too.
Right, right.
But I used to love, they had this like water wave. They had this like wave of water.
Oh, it's not Sesame Place was a water park.
You said what?
I said not Sesame Place was a water park.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. I don't remember it.
Or was that Dorney Park?
No, it might have been Sesame Place.
No, it was Sesame Place.
Cool.
I remember the animals.
I've always seen it like, you know, like the brown, like the staircase and like the brick buildings and stuff like that. So I didn't know they had water.
Have I ever been to Sesame Place? Because I don't remember. I'm starting to think it was Dorney Park. Listen, either way, y'all know damn well that damn character denied those black girls.
Rosalita?
I'm going to stay off that because I don't really know what the Spanish speaking people.
I think it's Rosita. It's Rosita.
Y'all know.
She shaded them little girls.
And it's probably a dude because how would they fit the costume? Right. You know what I'm saying? Because it looked like it was really tall too. Like, you know. But y'all should. You know damn well that was not an isolated situation where they were like, oh, the baby. Oh, they were saying no to, like, hugging a baby. No, it was very clear that they said no to that black child.
It was two of them. So what happened was, in the video, you see, like, she's walking down the street, and she does wave off someone else, and then she looks at the little girls and waves them off, too.
That junk was so shady. It was
so shady, because she was like, and then, like, just peaced out. And then Sesame Street, they released their apology.
They released a little statement talking about it wasn't even that.
Very like backhanded, like, meh, that's what they do. I think they said that the character was saying no to somebody who was asking for a video.
And it was a lie.
Which apparently is against their policy. So, but even if that was the case, that's why I said she did wave off someone else. And then you see in the video, she looks at the little girls and waves them off too. So even if that was the case, like, you still saw those little girls. And there was also another video where she did say hi and hug another little girl of another little race of another race. So of course it became
right.
We did these to two little black girls.
Because even in that specific video, you can clearly see that's not what was. Listen, and I get it. These performers, they don't make a lot of money. Mm-hmm. They're hot in that thing. They got them ice coolers inside or whatever to keep them cool.
Not ice coolers.
Isn't it?
Listen, they might. I think it's
like dry eyes.
Not dry eyes.
I feel like they had like a protectant, and then it's like dry eyes, and then it's like, I don't know. Listen.
But I did put on the Jaguar and at Arts.
At Arts?
Mm-hmm. I did, but that was just.
Not you was a mascot.
I did it for fun.
Oh, what high we sing to you, to the green and gray we're true. That was a moment.
Anyway.
Yes. Let's get back to, you can clearly see in the video that it was discrimination. Mm-hmm. I feel like Tamika Mallory got involved, right?
I didn't see that. I did see Kelly Rowland respond.
Oh, Kelly Rowland definitely.
Yeah. She was on the red carpet for something and they asked her about it.
And one of my friends on Facebook was like, I just bought tickets to Sesame Place for my kids. She was over. I was like, we better take them kids to Sesame Place. It wasn't. Didn't happen where you was going. All Sesame Places ain't the same now. We can't just.
Yeah, Kelly Rowland definitely responded and called more attention to it.
Yeah.
It was just blatant, like, just a poor
I really feel like Tamika Mallory absolutely.
I wouldn't be surprised if she did.
I feel like she did something, like showed up. I want to see.
No, she showed up at the Sesame Street.
I feel like she did. Tamika.
Let me tell you something. Something go down, Tamika is showing up. She is there.
Listen, Sesame Place discrimination press conference.
Wow.
She did. July 20th. So wow, I knew I saw her and she went live. Like, and they were standing there. I was like, listen, because
this is an injustice. But you know why
I love that? Because if we don't make these issues big and really fight for ourselves on these quote unquote smaller issues, then nobody else will. Nobody will take us serious when it comes to the larger things.
Right.
So I understand probably her point of view where it's like, this is bigger than just that.
Yeah.
This is like, no, let me say something. Let me be loud. Let me be serious about it so that this won't happen again. Kind of like my situation. Well, okay. I don't want to say too much. But
We'll get there.
Yeah. But it's like, you know, it's important to do that. You have to speak up. you really, really do have to speak up.
Yeah, and they just need to do a better job at making sure, because if it was an oversight on the actor's or performer's end, right. they need to do a better job at making sure things like that don't happen. It's about being intentional and being aware. It's like kind of like a read the room situation.
Exactly.
Like, if you see two little black girls, and also what I wanted to say was like Sesame Street was originally for little black kids in the Harlem. Urban communities, yeah. Black kids, Hispanic kids. So to be a little black girl and go to Sesame Place,
it's
and,
you exciting. Know, yeah.
It's so exciting. Obviously, they were excited to see that specific character, and that's just like. Heartbreaking to, you know, be in that situation.
Get turned down like that. Like you said, like, read the room. Know what's, understand race and relations and how that affects right. whatever like that. And then like make a choice. You could have cleared that up better.
Definitely. And also going back to the actor, like a huge chunk of your job is to entertain those kids. It's so whether there was, whether the adult that yeah. they were with was asking for a video, which is against policy, the children are still there. So that should be your focus. That should be, you know, she ran off like she was trying to get to her 15.
It was like,
like oh, time in the clock. What time is it? They said I was supposed to be out here at 6. It is 6:02. I am going
out of there. Let's get into the next
segment. It's just the real. The real. The real. The real. The real. The real. For real.
For real. T.D. Jakes. Pass the T.D. Jakes. Listen, he's not necessarily in hot water, but he definitely did say some things that triggered a lot of people. And it definitely triggered me, and I'm not even a woman. And I just felt like I had to say something. Because the problem is for me at least, is when black men don't say enough when stuff like this comes out. They usually agree with it or just don't say nothing at all. And black women just get left out here, just, you know, looking any old kind of way. And I just felt like I couldn't do that. And even though he's a respected, revered man, T.D. Jakes, Pastor T.D. Jakes is just human, and sometimes he messes up too. And as much as people revere him to be this perfect human being who has the advice and the right thing to say, mm-hmm. I felt like this time he was, you know, living in the flesh. I don't think spirit was in this. I don't think God was in this at all. He sounded very bitter, very weird. And you don't have to take my word for it. I do believe that the message that he was trying to get across was poignant and could be, you know, better served, talked about differently. But the way he delivered it and things he said, I didn't really like that. So we're gonna listen to it. And this is something I've never actually done before, like out loud, but I felt like it needed to be in the room versus in my, listen, Gupta has been on break.
Gupta has been on vacation.
Where has Gupta been?
I don't know. I think they left us in, we was in the Bahamas and such.
Listen, got upset because we didn't take, okay, I get it. See? I get it now. Okay. Gupta is a little upset. But listen, mm-hmm. Gupta, I'm going to get you back later. But let's listen to this.
Breaks all sociological order to the culture we're living in now. Because we're raising up women to be men.
Just let's raising up women to be men.
That's just not true.
It's just not true. It's literally not true. Who is going into that with that intention? That statement is an intended statement. Like mm-hmm. you would have to be like intending to do that. We are raising up women to be men. No. Yeah.
It is more circumstantial than intentional.
Exactly. It's circumstantial. It's circumstantial. Excuse me. Yes. Listen, social worker. You said it's circumstantial.
I'm done.
I love it. I love it. I see where you went with that. Wait, I'm sorry. Let me play the rest of it. He got the claps that he was looking for.
Of course he did.
And you are not applauded for your femininity. You are applauded in the contemporary society by how tough, rough,
I also just feel like it's a bunch of stuff jumbled up together. He says you're not applauded for your femininity.
False.
Full stop. Black women, of all women, are applauded for their femininity. Their feminine walk, their feminine talk, their feminine hair, their feminine clothing, fashion, like, the black feminine is the standard. It's the cultural standard, which means it's applauded.
Yeah, it don't feel like that sometimes, though.
What do you feel like is applauded? Women,
It's like, I understand what he's saying when it's saying like, oh, well, you got to be, you know, big boss chick, whatever, for somebody to understand you, you know, to think that you're someone type
situation. I don't think that makes you not feminine.
Yeah, I get what you're saying.
Because to right, I love, because does it mean
I love that we have a black woman here, because right. I think the one of the worst things that can happen is for two or just men to be in front of a mic talking about black, how women black think women, and what women feel. So I'm glad she's here.
But to your point, I just don't think that makes you not feminine. Being a boss or being aggressive or being those are not non-feminine traits. They're just
so
generally the precedent is settled. The precedent, this weird precedent, which is not even true, is that is a masculine trait. When it's more like a necessity trait, it's not if you're masculine, you're aggressive and boss. It's what is the necessity? And for a long time, men had to be, or at least men forced women to be less than. Mm-hmm. Women didn't have rights. Women had to go to men for everything. I remember you saying this earlier when we were talking. Couldn't buy a house, couldn't buy a car, couldn't get a loan, couldn't get a bank account, couldn't vote without their husband being there. That was a necessity. When women started to come into their own power, of course it's gonna take some time. Mm-hmm. Of course it's gonna feel a little different if I now make more money than you and you yelling at me acting crazy and I pull out that card like, well, I'm the one who paid the bills.
Yeah.
When men say it, it's masculine. It's supposed to be that way. But when a woman says it, it's like you're raising women to be men. How?
So going back to the women aren't applauded for their femininity, do you feel that way? Do you feel like you're not rewarded or applauded or encouraged to be feminine as a black woman?
And before you answer that, what does it mean to be feminine?
Right, that's what I was going to ask you, actually, because I feel like we're getting into gender roles, which is not exactly, you know, me.
Cut and dry.
Right. So I don't feel like I'm being encouraged or whatever to be feminine.
Or applauded for it is the word that TD Jakes uses.
Applauded for being feminine. Sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
From who?
Oh, just be from like random type people.
Is it society, like a white person thing, or is it like your own people?
Usually my own people. I don't think I've ever felt like, see, but then it goes into circumstances, you know what I'm saying? Because like as a single mother, it's not like, yes, I am a woman, so yes, I embody femininity just because like I'm a woman, I embody that. But I don't always get a chance to express that.
Right.
So maybe that's where we're going with this in a way, because a woman can't always express her femininity. If you talk about being sensual and flowing, like, you know, a certain way, like, we can't always do that because we have other things to do.
You can know I what tell saying? You?
Can
I tell you how I think that black women or women are applauded for being feminine?
Sure.
For me, it shows up, it's black women specifically, I see it where you guys are the standard for so many other cultures for our culture, like black women's body types, black women's fashion trends, black women's personalities, characteristics, mannerisms, like so many people aspire to and just pick up on and emulate you
the
guys.
The aesthetic.
Just
right, but, and I feel you. I feel all of that, but it feels like it's right for everybody except us.
Oh, gotcha. I see what you're saying.
You know what I mean?
Understood.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I get what you're saying. But okay, so based on what he was saying though, which was I suppose an adverse, which is like the opposite of that, the antithesis of that, which is a more masculine thing that you get applauded for that. I disagree with that because the angry black woman trope is not an applaud.
Oh, definitely not.
That's not an applaud. That's a disenfranchised situation. So it's like, why are you saying this? I would love to sit his ass down and ask him. What made you, like, why
I
would you say
like
that?
I feel like you're saying we're raising women to be independent then.
And
do you know
that's,
what I'm saying?
That's because where my like, problem, right.
Yeah.
That's
would
where
you,
my problem
would you raise your daughter to be independent?
You know I am. And I don't have a problem with that.
Right. Yeah.
So I don't, that's where now.
But your daughter is the most girliest girl. But I mean, like, as far as, like, naturally.
Uh-huh.
She may think, because she is a very...
She'll come for you.
Yes. But but now, like, she's so girly, a soft voice, and, you know, she's I wouldn't ever think she wasn't a feminine, you know, spirit.
Right. Just a strong feminine.
Yeah.
What bothers me mostly about what TD Jake said is that I feel like black women are the only group of a race of women who are not rewarded or applauded or encouraged to go after everything they want. You know what I mean? Like, I have, you know, have white friends in the, you know, who are taught to marry rich or go after the multiple degrees, get the six-figure paying job, move out of state if you need to. You know what I mean? Like, so black women can't strive for those things without being perceived as masculine.
As masculine, yeah.
And it's just, to me, it's kind of, I don't know, it screams fragile male ego to me, yeah. Because...
And it's archaic. It's archaic ideas.
Yeah. It's archaic, it's regressive. It kind of speaks to, like, I want to keep women,
but also I want to play the rest of it too, mm-hmm. because just because I know somebody gonna try to bring it up, acting like we played a whole clip, so let me play the rest of it, because what you're saying, he's jumbled up a lot of things, and what you're saying sort of dismisses this next part, which we didn't even play yet, which has something to do with, like, breaking up the family. Right, so let me just go into this.
Again, fragile male ego, because why does a woman have to need a man in order for you to feel validated in your role in her life?
And as a man myself, I don't have, my value is not in my masculinity. My value is not in my power. My value is not in my money. My value is not in my what I can do for you. Mm-hmm. My value is in my existence.
Right.
Simply put, I'm human. I exist. I am valuable. Here. That's it. That's all I have to do. Now being that man, being strong, being having money and being financially responsible and taking care of your family, those are great traits, but they are not male traits.
They're not.
Because I would want the same thing from my mother. Right. And I would want the same thing from my father. And I would want the same thing from my partner if I was, you know, in a relationship, regardless of gender. I would want those same attributes.
Yeah.
And if you apply it to gender, you dismiss the... So if that's what a man does, then what the hell... What does a woman do?
Yeah.
And that's why I wanted to ask you, like, in your relationship, gender roles, what is the big thing? Like, what is it that you are, as a woman, not doing that makes you a woman, that makes a man feel, or at least comfortable to be a man? Like, what is the thing?
What am I not doing?
Yeah. Because apparently doing anything... having any of those other things is not effeminate. But, okay... So what is it? Like, what is it that men want women to do?
I have no idea.
Girl.
Hello, I'm single still. But,
And it's not because you're masculine.
I mean, it's not because I'm masculine. I have no idea, because I know for myself, like, I'm not the one to be, like, completely 100% domesticated. You know what I'm saying? Like, okay, you come home to dinner and da-da-da, and I just cleaned it. I don't mind helping out, helping each other out, that kind of situation. But if that's all you're looking for in a woman, you know what I'm saying? That's not me. As far as...
And that doesn't make you not feminine.
Right, exactly. Now, the one thing...
Your mother must have raised you like a man.
The one thing he did say is, if you didn't create a need, if you don't create a need for me to pour into, whatever the case is, just because I can get my own things, that don't...
I don't need you
to talk to.
That's what
I'm
saying.
Or to anything.
Yes,
like
I can
that.
Pay my bills, but you can pay it.
And not even that. It's just like, there's other things. You know what I'm saying? Like, that doesn't make you everything because I'm paying a bill or something like that.
Yeah.
It's dumb.
It's gender. It's like archaic gender roles. Like, what does that even
and
have
I,
to do with
I think,
anything?
I think what he says also takes away, like, women's autonomy over their existence. You know what I mean?
Over their being.
I know many women who love for their boyfriends, husbands to be the man and pay the bills, be the financial provider, do all those things.
And men love that too. I personally like that.
Right. And I also know women who pay their own bills, pay their mortgages, pay their car notes, take care of their children, and still have men in their lives. I mean, you know, and or in a relationship. But it's not they don't rely on them in that way or right. need them in that way right. as women used to. So I think, it just takes women.
Relying. Yeah.
What he's saying really just puts women back into the 50s and 60s. And he's saying, like, this is what makes women feminine, and this is what needs to.
This is what you should stick to. This is the standard. Stick to the status quo.
And it's just, yeah, it's disheartening.
It's disheartening because.
Especially coming from a man like
T.D. Jakes. Like T.D. Jakes, who is often.
Who knows so much.
A progressive. Right. Mm. You know, Christian spirit who has compassion and understanding Definitely. For these things. And he seemed bitter and angry and loud and wrong.
Right.
It didn't seem, like I said, he was speaking from the flesh. It did not seem like something the spirit would say. In fact, I know for a fact, Christ.
did not lead you to say that.
Would not say such things.
Oh my God.
Because it's not even logical. Right. I remember Amanda Seale saying once on The Breakfast Club, she was like, this is the thing. I really don't need you for those things, for taking care of my rent and my this and my da 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 da, taking out the trash and getting my oil changed. Little things that people associate with things that a man are supposed to do. Mm-hmm. She was like, I really don't need you to do that, but I want you to do that. Right. And she was like, I just feel like the power of want is so much better than need, because if you can need anything, but me choosing to have you here,
right.
me choosing to allow you to have that space, we are together and you're setting these rules, okay, so you take out the trash, babe, I love that, you mm-hmm. take out the, I mean, you go get the car fixed or whatever you do, I want you to do those things, but I don't need you to do
well, I want
like
you
let's be clear like, I don't need you to do that
right.
but I want you to do that yeah. and like you said, I want you to want to do that mm-hmm. too, because a lot of men will not
right.
and it doesn't make them not a man,
right?
These gender roles is what he was talking about. But I just want to touch back on this topic. We raise our women to be men. You put both women and men in that sentence. First of all, it was gaslighting, manipulating the audience so they can get a reaction. Mm-hmm. Weird. That was not of the flesh. I mean, that was of the flesh, not of the spirit. But the fact, this is the thing. When women say, I don't need a man. That is not a factual statement that even the women who are saying it believe. It is a statement out of hurt. It is a statement out of trauma. It is a response. Mm-hmm. It is a response. It's not a raised thought, is my point. Mm-hmm. Nobody is raising their child like, you don't need a man. You don't need a man. You don't need a man. Men, you don't need them. nobody's actually doing right. that.
Affirmation.
Especially not black people. Maybe white, I don't know. But I don't know them. Nobody's actually doing that. Anytime a woman has ever said, I don't need no man, it's out of response. But wait. And not of men, but of one man or two men that they probably met in their life. Yeah. It's a very specific response to something that hurt them. It is not a grandiose, generalized idea that women don't need men. Now, again, black women. I don't know about them white feminists and all that mess they be doing. That ain't black folk. We ain't doing that. That ain't us. That's them. But generally, black women, especially black women, especially all the stuff that black women go through with black men, are always on the front lines, mm-hmm. are all, even when they're powerful, even when they're strong, even when they have money, are still showing up. Juicy lips, mm-hmm. body thick, curves, ass pressed up and, boobs up, looking real feminine, giving you, sassy, whatever, and powerful on the front lines defending your black ass.
It's still mm-hmm. articulate, intelligent, all of those
things. All of those things. Yeah. And still, even not all of us, domesticated, cooking, cleaning, taking care of the kids. And
right.
none of this stuff has actually, especially with the millennial generation, has actually happened in a way that even needs to be talked about on this stage. Mm. Now, if it was like a epidemic of like, we hate men, right, I could see where this has come from.
Yeah.
But you're talking about something that doesn't even exist. You're creating stuff for the purpose of some claps. And it's just like, but why? You don't even need to do that. Well, we could, and then there was no compassion in what he said. He could have easily just said, I think we need to talk more about how there are some women who are going into a dark space where they feel like they don't need men. But why do they feel that way? That's of Christ. Yeah. Let's get to the reason why they feel that way. But you just making statements like this, it's like, whoa. Right.
And somehow the call to action always falls back on black women.
On women to fix the problem. Because
it's like, we're raising women to be too masculine. So women, y'all need to fix that. Y'all need to stop being praised or looking to be praised for your masculinity. Be more feminine. Be more soft.
I literally don't know anybody who praises a black woman for being angry. He said, he was like coming home bragging about the fact that you get praised for being mean and nasty and mean-spirited. Where?
Never.
I've never even seen that. Never. Even one of the most hardest chicks in the game, Cardi B, is very soft and feminine when it comes to her husband, Offset. Right? Real pink and squishy. And she be saying some reckless stuff, but she gets very motherly.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And that's just her natural vibe. It's like, where are you even getting this? TD, if somebody hurt you, just say that.
Because that's what it was. It just sounds like
it's giving bitter
male ego. It sounds like,
did your wife say a thing?
I want to keep women in this marginalized space, and it makes me uncomfortable that women are
right. But then, what if a man really can't do those things? Then he's gonna feel like emasculated, then, right?
Girl, and we talked about that,
right?
And emasculation is not even a man thing. Right. It's not even a gender thing. It just means. It has something to do with power. It's genderless, but yeah.
Right.
A loss of power.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Girl, listen, TD got us talking over time. What do y'all think? I would love to know. I think I'm gonna put this clip on Instagram. What would y'all think about that? I don't know. Let's get into this very last segment, y'all.
Seek, and we shall find.
So for this last segment, I had to bring somebody on that you all know, but you've never seen before. This is Christina Lowe.
Hey, guys.
This is Sweet and Low, huh?
Sweet and low.
So this
low
is
low down here.
Listen, don't do me.
I'm just saying.
Okay, let me get down, because you...
I can get up like that.
Girl, this actually kind of
hurt.
Why are you down here?
I don't know.
Anyway, does this look right? Okay. We got Rob running the camera now. But anyway, listen, this is the voice of reason that you all always here, but after all of the stuff that we talked about today on the podcast, I think compassion is the word that comes to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, you know, sometimes I like to talk to Merriam-Webster since 1828.
Mm-hmm.
Compassion, always.
Always.
Listen, mm-hmm. Sympathetic consciousness of others' distress together with a desire to alleviate it. I didn't feel no compassion in T.D. Jakes' sermon, quote-unquote sermon. He was, you know, but alleviate. That's the part of compassion that I love so much.
Right.
It's your concern to alleviate. I don't want you to feel this thing. I want you to feel better. Or at least I'm looking at you thinking, oh, man, I know how you feel.
Yeah.
And I think if we just had a little bit more compassion for one another, we would have a better understanding for one another. And it all ties into all the things that I've been talking about on this segment of understanding. Compassion, consideration, hope, love, whatever I've talked about, it all ties into the idea of understanding. I think if we all understood each other a little bit more, we would all be in a better place. But you can't understand somebody if you don't have no compassion for them now.
Amen.
When I see a homeless person on the street, okay, that was a line from Michael Jackson.
AC.
Listen, it's giving Mary. Listen, hold on. Let me pull out my.
Gonna make a change.
Yeah. Who's in my life? Listen, you see why I had her on the. She be encouraging the foolishness. Okay, Christina, what are your thoughts about compassion?
I mean, I think you hit it spot on, and I feel like there's also a component to compassion that states or brings forth, even if you don't understand. You don't have to fully understand someone to know that, to recognize them as a human being, as a person. That's what diversity is and all of that.
Girl.
Okay.
And you don't even need a lot.
You don't.
You just need a small bit of compassion can go a long way.
Right.
And some of y'all don't even have that. Let me get back to the peacefulness of it all. But I think we just need a lot more compassion. And if we had that, I think there would be a lot less fight, like arguments, You know, like dissension is what I want to say. It would be a lot less dissension because we would be able to be quiet and hear what someone is going through and ask the question, why? That's what I'm doing here at the podcast. Why do you feel that way? Why are you thinking like this? If you can't even do that, it's like...
All right, for what? Then just shut up.
You said it. Listen, I just also want to give you your flowers. You were super, super mom today.
Thank you.
Went to work. Got your daughter hair done.
I went to pick up their food before I got
Beat
here.
Beat your face. Got your food for your kids. Hello? And then you came here. You came here on time. Well, you came here in enough time.
Right.
You came here. You got here.
Done.
Period.
There we go.
And you did the podcast. You showed up. Listen, you were super mom. Okay, because she's about to leave me.
Sorry, I didn't know. I'm sorry. I was like feeling it.
I was super mom. I get it. You deserve that. Listen, I don't know too many people like you. Okay? If I had two kids, I wouldn't be doing nothing. Nothing.
I mean, they're older now. When they was younger, I was like,
girl, okay, F them kids. F them kids. I mean, you love your kids, I think, but...
Yes.
I know. Listen, my prayer is that I, through comedy, entertainment, and personal experiences, will help each and every listener seek understanding for one another. I will not always get it right. Listen, I will change my mind. I may even speak out of turn. But I do this with love, and I'm asking for grace to heal through conversations in a safe space, to tackle community issues that the truth will reveal with no circumlocution, just the real, for real. And we're out. You can listen to the uncensored version of The Real For Real on Apple or Spotify Podcast.